And as I said, I'm not talking about a George Miller set. I'm talking about a Sidney Pollack set. You know, just dialogue or just in, now with what we're talking about, and the reason why Rodriguez probably got up and said, "How did you do that?" Because to have a production like this, and the worst thing that happened was somebody broke their leg or sprained their ankle, and that's it. That's a blessing. That's a blessing, because every time he yells action, I'm sure his heart is in his throat, you know, hoping someone, you know, he in the behind the scenes, that scene that you're talking about where the truck turns on is at the end where Nux dies. He was holding his breath in Video Village, you know, hoping that this guy, because the dummy that was on the truck turns on his head, and he actually thought that was the stunt guy.
Yeah, so he was so worried.
Yeah, he was really worried. So, you know, just big up to him, to George Miller, for giving us such a great piece of art. No one getting hurt, because that's the concern in pre-production. Because I'm sure there were a lot of films that might have been had the same type of storyline as The Road Warrior, as is Fury Road. And producers probably said, you know what? We can't afford it. There's no way in the world we can make this look realistic. And if we shoot it, somebody's going to die or somebody's going to get hurt. We need to scrap this production and move on to something else. Because no one, you know, when Road Warrior came out, there were a whole lot of films that came out after that that kind of gave us or tried to emulate what Road Warrior was. None of them could do it. And I don't think if you've noticed, since Fury Road has come out, there have been no films that actually resemble Fury Road, you know, because they can't match. They cannot match up to what he's done.
And I really appreciate the safety on here as well, like you said. So you have a movie like Resident Evil. There was a stunt woman who lost her leg because there was a mix. Like, she was driving a motorcycle and the crane didn't lift soon enough, the camera crane, and she lost her leg. Recently, on a CW show, there was an instance with a cherry picker and lights and a PA who was standing on, like, people weren't looking out. People were either coming up with stunts that my thing is, you shouldn't do a stunt where if one thing fails, there's a chance for death. Does that make sense? Now, George Miller did that on this with a truck, but they really built a safety. The guy walked out of it. They thought long and hard about it. But you shouldn't have something where there could be a random error. Or you shouldn't have, when you're on film sets, you need to make sure that your inexperienced PAs aren't standing underneath lights on cherry pickers. And, I don't know, watching him really gave me a lot of respect for him. But also, if you look at the IMDb page for this movie, there's five stunt coordinators. So normally there's a fight choreographer too in this movie. So in most films, there's one stunt coordinator. This one had five. And there was the fight coordinator as well, who he worked on Gymkhana, by the way. The guy who did the Richard Norton, the fight coordinator.
Okay.
And he also did the Suicide Squad movies. But yeah, so I dig that there's five coordinators, stunt coordinators on this movie. So they wanted safety, and they achieved it. Yeah. But that's when you do it right. You do it right.
And then you want to leave a project feeling good about it, because I don't know. I mean, I've never experienced it, and I hope I never experience it in my career as a filmmaker, that no one gets hurt or dies on set. Now, you know, scratches or bumps and bruises, that happens. But someone really getting hurt or someone dying, I mean, that can kind of take you out of the art. And I don't know if that happened with Christian Bale in The Last Batman, where he said he didn't want to do anymore. But that's when a guy shot up the movie theater, just killing people. So even not in the production itself, but just something that you make, and it pushes people so far as to murdering people. You know, we don't create this art. We're not here for people to get hurt during production or even after the film is done. It's a piece of art. You know, so as you said to him, yeah, you know, taking the time, it's all about planning. Sure, if he didn't plan as much as he did, people probably could have gotten hurt. You know, there's no way in the world when you watch this film, I'm saying to myself when I watched it, someone had to get hurt.
Have you read the excellent oral history of what happened on the Crow set that led to Brandon Lee being shot?
From what I remember, props had the gun. They were about to shoot. Something happened. Props took the gun back, returned it, and I don't know. What did you hear?
So it was one guy who was overworked, and he was just working 20 hours around the clock. Wasn't sleeping, and he just had so many bullets and guns, And he didn't fully, he was so exhausted that a couple slipped through, just some things slipped through because he wasn't, he was so overworked and so tired.
But what doesn't make sense to me and what you're saying is why have live rounds on set at all?
I think it's just something slipped. I think it was in North Carolina in different studios. I'm not saying this is because of North Carolina, but I just think it was, they took it for granted. They had one guy, he got too tired. He didn't expect everything. It's a good read. It's a good read about overworking your crew and the dangers that can happen.
That's a rough one, you know?
It's rough.
That's a rough one.
But man, yeah. I've been on sets where they didn't set up a camera. What do you call it when you put up when you're working on a skyscraper and you put the things up on the outside, what do you call those?
The scaffolding.
They had cheap scaffolding and then it fell on some of the crew and hurt a first AD on a movie I was working on. I was working on a movie where we were in the Everglades and or a TV show, and I walked into a gator hole in the ground and I almost sunk in and someone yelled, "Protect the camera." So the industry is not kind to people, man. So once again, that's why I like George Miller so much.
I mean, you know, they're thinking about the equipment more than anything. The woman that passed away, Sarah, in Georgia.
Oh, that director. Oh,
yeah. Man. So, you know, safety. And are you guys listening? All the films that we're talking about, anytime that I'm on set, anytime I'm dealing with crew, we always talk about safety. Everybody wants to make it home.
That's right.
You know?
And that's if you're the head of it, that's your job. No, well, you know what? I've been told I was on a big set one time and a massive lightning storm broke out. I'm not going to tell a story. I'm still mad about it. But yeah, so also another thing about this movie, I'm going to change the topics. So I wrote a note. You know you're watching a good movie when you see water being wasted and it hurts. When that water is being wasted in that scene, it just broke my soul. I was like, turn it off. Don't waste water.
I thought about that too. I said, well, that's a lot of water.
Exactly.
That's what I kept saying to myself, man, that's a lot of, I wonder if they're recycling the water, you know, but that's a lot of water. And it didn't look like an effect. That looked practical as well.
Another thing I was thinking about. So she was there, Charlize Theron's, Theron's character was there at the Citadel for 7,000 days, about 19 years. I guess that'd be cool to see how she became the, Imperator? Like that'd be neat. Cause that she had a massive position in that War Boy squad.
Yeah. Yeah. How she lost her arm. Did they speculate on how she lost her arm?
I don't know, but I'd love to see it. I guess, you know what? Going back in time, I guess I wouldn't mind it. That'd be pretty cool. And I also like when Flick, who is Nux's kind of nemesis and partner, when he dies, he's just happy about it. And he just gets squished. Just blows my mind, man. It's just, and also the scene where Rictus pulls up the engine at the end and Nux looks at him.
Uh-huh.
You know that guy, Nathan Jones, fought in Pride in MMA and he got his butt kicked. That's a seven-foot giant, and he just got beat up. Blows my mind.
Most of the big guys get beat up anyway, but yeah, he's 7 foot tall, is he?
Yeah. Wow. Oh, yeah, huge dude. Any other things you want to cover in this film? Oh, you wanted to talk about the soundtrack, right?
Oh, yeah, the soundtrack. Okay, so Junkie XL is the composer for this well-put-together piece, and he does a great job. I mean, if you listen to the motifs in the film, they do so much for the film.
Oh yeah,
and it's a very distinct sound, and music is important. I mean, we've been talking about the action, we've been talking about all these things, but knowing on how a score and a theme actually holds a film together. And it has to fit well. It has to sound good. It has to fit well. It has to fit the character. And the most important thing is not supposed to take you out of the story or take you out of the film. So I think he did a great job. He goes under another name called Tom Holkenborg, right? He did Terminator Dark Fate. He did Superman, Man of Steel, Alita, Battle Angel. I mean, I think about all these scores, and they were pretty good, but just not as good as the score in Fury Road. He's actually doing Godzilla versus King Kong.
Ooh, I like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that'll sound epic.
That's coming out. I don't know when it's coming out now, you know, with the quarantine and COVID, but hopefully that'll give us some more of him. But if you listen to the film, and there are simple motifs that he's using, like the sounds and the chords that he's using are very simple, but they're very strong. You know, they fit the film really well. So You know, I'm big on scores. Like I like music in film.
The Warriors. I love the score in The Warriors that they play about three times. I love that score, man.
The Warriors.
Anything by Carpenter, I dig. I dig all the Carpenter scores.
Oh, yeah. Electronic. He's electronic. And that's similar to, what's that, the Dorf brothers, the guys that do Stranger Things?
Yep.
So that electronic sound, that came back from, like, the 60s. These two brothers, I forget their names, but these two brothers actually built in these instruments made out of electronics. And they're the ones that kind of spawned the electronic sound in film. And like you said, Carpenter, you got Tangerine Dream. That's another band.
I have that Sorcerer score. I have that vinyl. I love the score to Sorcerer. Okay. It's beautiful. Okay. And Near Dark.
Yeah. Which one is that?
Near Dark, Catherine Bigelow, the vampire movie with Bill Paxton.
Yeah.
I love their stuff. But, yeah. And also, this is random, but how great is the headbutt in this movie that Furiosa delivers at the end?
Okay, so... supposedly, right before she delivers that headbutt, is it with Erictus' character? No, it's another guy. It's the guy that played the stunt. He's a stunt coordinator.
Yep, and he was on there with him.
Right. He gives the same hiss sound that was done in the Road Warrior that was done. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So that's where that hiss sound came from.
And then she, and then I also love when she goes to stab him and she misses and bonks her head. That's a good gag in there when she.
Oh yeah, it's a pretty good gag. I don't know if it fits, but it worked.
Yeah, I guess. And I also like how in every car it was a shoe size kind of thing where you test your shoe size for all the pedals and then you can lock it and keep the thing floored. It's kind of cruise control in the post-apocalyptic age. I dig it. There's so many little details. We could talk about this movie. Is there any final things you want to talk about before we get out of here?
No. Well, yeah. What I'll say is, as I said, Fury Road. If you want to watch a really good film, good action film that makes sense and it was done carefully, and you can watch this film and not feel bad at the end, knowing that no one in production was really hurt making the film, and understand, you know, what it's about. Like you were saying, show it, not say it, really using images, juxtaposition to tell your story. Great film. And then, like you said, George Miller's wife edited the film. That's another great thing. So yeah, just a good all around film, action film nominated, like you said, 10 Academy Awards. That's an accomplishment, everybody. Know that that's an accomplishment. Know that there are a whole lot of filmmakers out here that have made action films, pretty good action films, but none nominated. Not for 10 Academy Awards. No.
So good.
So, great film. So great. Great film.
What are we doing next?
What did we say? What's next?
Well, you have some driving movies. You said the Mad Maxes, 7-Ups, Bullet. 7-Up, Bullet.
Bullet. I mean... even in the second Matrix film, the drive scene that they did, even though that was CGI and the other films we're talking about are actually practical.
They built that highway.
Yeah. I mean, but it was a good scene.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
That was a great car scene. So I don't know, maybe we'll go cars. I don't know, Bullet or 7-Ups or, you know, we'll get something.
I like Bullet, man. I like that idea.
You like Bullet? I think so. Let's talk about Bullet. Right. I mean, we don't hear enough about Steve McQueen. Steve McQueen did a lot for the film industry. He did a lot for it. You know, he was an icon. He took Hollywood by the rings and controlled his own destiny. So I like that about McQueen.
We just got to make sure to not wear a sweet turtleneck. All right. Remember, he got jealous of James Garner's turtleneck on Great Escape.
Oh, that's what it was?
Yeah, James. Well, look, type in James Garner turtleneck, Great Escape. The dude looks amazing. And so he was annoyed that he didn't get something that looked so good.
Really?
Allegedly, but that's what you hear about that on set.
As I mentioned, we talked about great films, so I said Shogun Assassin and Great Escape. You get a chance, watch the Great Escape. Old film, 60 what? Great Escape was what, 69?
Yeah, 69. I think you're right.
Is it 69?
I was gonna say 65.
Oh, let's just see really quick.
63.
63?
Yeah.
Oh, I was off. 63. But a great, great action film, great story. But I didn't know about the turtleneck and James Garner. I have to look that one up. That's interesting about the film.
I'm telling you, just type in James Garner turtleneck, Great Escape. The dude.
I remember his turtleneck was pretty cool in the film, you know.
I mean, no, yeah, you can admit to that. It's totally fine.